Finally, it's time for Midnights. It's your boy, Tommy Mars. If you're one of my patrons watching this, you are watching the full unedited version this morning. I hope you enjoy it. If you're watching this on YouTube, you're watching this in a couple parts. That's going to be busted up enough that I can get it on here and not have it. Whatever way that you're watching, I hope that this episode finds you well. Okay, I literally cannot wait any longer. Let's dive in. Taylor Swift, Midnights. Let's roll. All right, first track tonight, first track on the album, Lavender Haze. When she announced this, I don't know, I just kind of got excited about the title and how she described it. So let's go, Lavender Haze. Oh, love that. Oh, man. I almost feel like I want to run back through that one right now. I'm not going to do it right now, but I almost feel like I want to hear that one again. That was amazing. That is, going into this, there was a couple tracks, and I asked on Twitter too. I was like, or was it, maybe it was on Patreon. I can't remember, but I asked somewhere and I said, hey, based on the titles of the songs that we have now, which one were you looking forward to the most? And, you know, everybody was kind of like, there's Antihero Karma and stuff. For me, it was Lavender Haze. I don't know what it was. I just kind of dug it. I liked her little backstory of it. Wow. That, I wasn't expecting it. I thought it was going to be different, but man, that is, that's a game changer to me. This what one song in. Game changer record. I don't know how I don't know how it shakes out the rest of it, but if this is any indication how this album's going to be, oh my gosh, we are in for a treat, album of the year type stuff. I mean, oh wow. So throughout the song, I felt it was almost like kind of a push and pull thing where I felt like she was giving us a little bit of hints of her past. I felt like it was like, not trying to sound crude here, but like, don't forget me, bitches. You know what I'm saying? I'm still T Swift, right? But then we were kind of getting these little nuggets of new and some of the vocal things she did there. And I like the, you know, those little swells. And she does swells before, but this was different. And this was with those like harmonic swells. And I'm just trying to get my head around it. Wow. And the production on it, man. I mean, it's just so good. And I love that low end, but so far, like listening to that song, I feel like what we're in for is, and I don't mean this in a sense of saying that it's lacking production, because it is not. It sounds so good. And there was like kind of dips in the music. If you heard, like it almost like it wanted to crack out for a second and then it's great. I mean, it's great, but there's almost a minimalist feel so far. And like listening to this one song, I feel like there's a little bit of a minimalist feel. But what's not minimalist is her, the way she's attacking the vocals. And on that first song, there was like, I swear, it was like a different effect that I've ever heard her before. And I don't mean like a synth harmonic. I don't mean that. I meant just even the type of reverb and stuff on it. It was just different. It awesome is what it is. Wow. Okay, so we're going to go to the next song. This is called Maroon.
Shaking, blind, and hazy. How the hell did we lose sight of us again? Sobbing with your head in your hands. Ain't that the way it always ends? You were standing hollow-eyed in the hallway. Carnations you had thought were roses. That's us. I feel you no matter what.
This is so good. I keep hearing that low. All right, so Maroon. I got to tell you something, man. That is the most fullest sounding, minimalist song I think I've ever heard. I mean, it was minimalist in a way in terms of like actual music and production. And it doesn't say that there's not a ton going on, because there is a lot going on. I mean, just listen to the program snare work and stuff. I mean, there's a lot going on. It's not just like one the whole time. There's those, you know, there's a lot happening there. But what I mean is like, there's not like a lot of noises and guitars and stuff coming at you. You just have this synth, this noise just kind of hanging out, hovering over everything. And then you've got this. Most time I've used this phrasing or this word is with Taylor stuff, and it's that ethereal sound. It's that heavy reverb sound, but not so much that it's like it overtakes everything. It's just enough to me to break up like the whole soundscape, but not go over the top where it becomes distracting. It just makes it sound big and lush, right? And then I kept hearing that low voice, and I was like, it's like that synth voice, that vocoder voice, but it's not a vocoder, but it's the synth voice. And it was that low note. And then when it, at the end there, when it kind of got quieter and you could hear her voice, and it was in there where it was a strain. But when I say strain, I didn't mean like she was straining. I meant like the tired voice, like the, and I don't know what she, I can't remember what she was saying there, but that with that synth voice, boy, oh boy, that was top notch. It's like, here's little tidbits of who I am. Here's where I'm going. And so you don't forget, and all the great things I've ever done. It's like all on its way, this album. Wow. Okay. So let's move on. We're going to go to the third song, and this one's called Antihero. And I've been waiting. Everybody's been talking about this one, boy. Let's go. Wow, that harm was sweet, right? Too big to hang out, slowly lurching toward your favorite city. Sam Taylor. You talk about perfecting your craft or a craftsmanship, songwriting, storytelling, vocals, vocal melodies. Oh my gosh. And when she went low and you can hear, the vocal cords, just the bumps in the road. And I don't think she's ever laid herself out like this. And it sounds crazy to say because it's Taylor, right? She writes from the heart. She wears it on her sleeve. She tells stories that nobody tells, that are personal stories. Romantic stories, whatever, failed friendships and stuff. I mean, I feel like that was her facing demons. It was her facing fears, putting it out there. She was like, it's almost like, you know, I would say in the majority of the songs, not all the songs, because there's times she has these moments of clarity in her writing, but most of the time I would say, maybe if she assesses blame, it bounces off of her. On that song right there, she's taking a risk and she's saying, hey, I'm dealing with my demons. I'm dealing with my thing. And wow. And okay, so I want to talk about the production before we leave this one. I love that. So there's a lot of low end fuzz. It's just low end in general, just the, you know, stuff that's happening. I mentioned, you know, I have my monitors here. I have the big boys on right now, so I'm getting a lot of bass response. But what I loved about it, there's a lot of bottom end, but it's so crystal clear. So there was that synth that was almost acting as the hi-hat during the verses. So it was like, that was happening. And then you hear those chords come in, and then there was like a pseudo hat where it's like, but it really wasn't a hat. You know, it was like a noise. There was different noises. It's great production. The sonics, everything about the mix, her voice. I mean, oh my goodness. I don't think I've ever heard her like this. This is, because it's not just about singing or singing notes. The harmonies are amazing, and they're like, they're just so next level, but it's her delivery. I swear this is the most believable I've ever felt. And this is coming from a person that says she is the greatest songwriter of this generation. And I don't even think it's close. I mean, I honestly swear to you, she's the best songwriter. And I'm saying with these first three songs, I feel like she's even leveled up, which is almost insane to even think, but wow. All right. Jeez. Talk about knocking on the park. Oh, song four. So this is Snow on the Beach featuring Lana Del Rey. Oh, heck, man, let's get into it. Quite like you did, and my flight was awful. Thanks for asking. I'm on blue. Thanks to you. And it's like snow. That's such an Evermore feel right there, right? God, I'm loving these vocal mixes. Gosh.
Now it's like snow at the beach. We're good, it was beautiful.
another planet. Now I'm all for you like Janet. Can this be a real thing, can I? Are we falling like snow at the beach?
The textures on these on this album is yeah, wow. So this Jack Antonoff is the producer on this, and I think I read he produced the whole thing. I guess let me make sure of that before I say. So producer Taylor Swift and Jack Antonoff. Wow. I mean, these things, there's so many subtle little things going on this album. I mean, it's like I stand by what I said with the minimalist approach, it truly is, but there's just so. The way everything is done and put in there, it is so good. I mean, I think it's going to be nominated for like Album of the Year. Well, I'm four songs in, so I don't want to jump the gun. But even off of these four songs, it almost should be. That's how good it is. But he's got to be nominated for producer too on that. I don't know if they'd co-share that or how that would work, actually. I'm not sure. Yeah, I think they both probably would get something for that. But. Well, it's on the nose. It has them both as a producer, so they should. But it's not just putting stuff in to put stuff in. I say it all the time. Like, a lot of times I'll say less is more, you know. But that doesn't mean to rip everything off or, you know what I mean, like strip everything back so you have less. That's not what it means. When I say less is more, it means not clogging up the whole spectrum, you know, of with just noise. You be... like really mindful of where you're putting everything and what exactly you're putting in. And that's exactly what's happening on this album right now. And I'm telling you, man, these vocal mixes, I've said it a lot of time on times on Taylor's records because it's just special. She has a really good sense of harmonies. And I think in the studio, man, I think they really try to come up with some really cool, you know, three part, sometimes four part harmonies, you know, and it's where they lay them out there. But it's not even the record where, cause like there was times on Folklore where I was just blown away how they were laid. Like you had a set of vocals here, here, and here on the spectrum, 0, 100, 100, and just laid out. And this is not that. This is a whole different kind of vocal mix that I'm just not used to hearing with Taylor's voice, but I'm just in love with him. And the thing is, it's not staying the same, the whole song. It's not like the whole song is one set of, plugins or whatever they're using for her vocals. It's constantly evolving throughout the whole song, just like the whole song's evolving. So it's not just it's the trifecta, man. The song is evolving musically. It's evolving lyrically, but it's also evolving from a vocal mix standpoint. It's freaking brilliant. I mean, I'm going to say it, man. This is a freaking brilliant record. Wow. Okay. Man, that's song four. All right, so this next one, when I saw this, You're On Your Own, Kid, it kind of reminded me of like, Here's Looking At You, Kid, you know, that type of thing. And this one has, I wanted to look at the writers. So on Snow on the Beach, it had featuring Lana Del Rey, but it also has the writers on it. So it's those three, Swift, Del Rey, and Antonoff. So it looks like all these songs mostly are Swift and Antonoff. And I'll make a mention when it's something that's different. But like the first song I wanted to recognize, so it has Taylor, Jack, Zoe Kravitz, Mark Spears. Who's that? Jahan Sweet. And is that Sam Du? I can't see that far. I think that's what it is. So hopefully I didn't butcher that. Wow, this is something else. All right, let's go to this next song. You're On Your Own, Kid.
Summer went away. Smoking with your boys. I touched my phone as it fit.
I like the mix of new Taylor vocals and old Taylor vocals. And you know exactly what I'm talking about. That. And that. New. I love that floor tom, and that's not like a replaced tom to me. That is an actual floor tom. Sounds great. That build. I mean, this album is like a masterclass in well, so many things, songwriting obviously, but in production too, because like these songs aren't what you would call like the bangers of today. You know what I mean? And I swear I got to get the waves of these and I got to load them in. And I want to see how the mastering looks on this, because I feel like they're going more for peaks and valleys and nuances in the mix than they are like a loudness war, which plays close to my heart, because if you've watched me long enough, you know, I hate the loudness wars because you lose the soul, I feel like, of the songs. Not happening here, man. I mean, I feel like you can feel those peaks and valleys. Yeah, and the other thing too, when I was talking about like, and I was thinking, you know, because there's a lot of bottom end here, but like I said, it's not like a traditional banger, which banger I feel like is kind of a newer thing, but it's not that it's thumping so hard. Like that kick it's more of the 909 flavor than it is the 808 flavor. You know what I mean? It's like 909 without a lot of bass there, where in like, I mentioned, like, if you really want that, you know, sound on a kick to be really, like, kind of glassy, really bassy, you notch it. You do a notch at, like, 55 to 60 hertz, and you make the cue point really small, and you notch it up, and you get, that's where you really get that boof sound. I almost feel like it's notched in the reverse. I almost feel like it's notched negative, and it's that synth fuzz that's really carrying the bottom end of this. It's really appealing. So it's really not like the banger thing, but it's still there. It still has that bass response, and it's not meant to beat you down with that. Okay. Oh, and so her vocal. So, you know, na, 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 body, you know, that thing to me, that's an old Taylor thing. She's been doing that for a long time. I actually enjoy it. I like it, but I like what she did there. She kind of brought in something a little new with that. I swear, call me crazy, but it's almost like, here's a couple reminders of who I am, but here's some new shit. You know what I mean? That's what I feel like. I mean, I have no idea if that's what she thought, but man. Oh, okay. So here's one I was looking forward to when the track listing got out there. Track 6, this is called Midnight Rain, and this is Swift Antonoff as credited as the writers. He wanted it comfortable, I wanted the pain. He wanted it. I was gonna say, is that Taylor on that voice, you know, slowed down? And that when it went, nah, nah, I was like, that is Taylor. It's gotta be. It's not just the notes, the way she says it. And he's using that. I'll talk about it at the end. I want to hear that low again. like that, that doom, 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 doom. It's just off. It's awesome.
Just what we wanted, just what we wanted. And he never thinks of me.
Okay, so another thing happens, like in that song there, you're going to be hard-pressed to find another song that is, in a weird way, cohesive like that, but odd. Because, like, when the chorus comes back in, listen to what was happening going on, like, with the... It was just, everything was just off. It was almost like the music didn't change to go in the chorus, but as soon as her voice kicks in and goes to that vocal melody, it carried it. Like, that vocal melody carries that song. But, like, even for the transitions, you know, it wasn't like a musical transition that was happening. It's like her voice went into the transition, and that's when it was, okay, so now we're back in the chorus. I mean, these two, I think, just gel together. I think they just, it's like hand in a glove, you know? Mustard and ketchup, salt and pepper, you know what I mean? Ham and burger. But for real, I feel like it's like one of those things, you know, you complete each other's sentences. I'm almost willing to bet they could probably complete each other's sentences, because I just think it would be hard to produce these type of songs coming out of a studio. These two, I just feel like it would be hard, because right there, that was a tough thing. And live, if she does play this song live, it's going to be kind of a, you know, there's in your monitors, your ear monitors, you're going to have that click, 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 because there's some drop off there musically, and where the voice is going to carry that. Wow. That is going to be powerful live too. I swear, you know what, man? So it's not like I haven't listened to all of her, because I have. I've listened to every song on every album that she's ever put out. At some point, I'm going to rank all the albums. But I'm not saying this is the most descriptive she's ever been, but I swear this is the most that she's putting out there of herself, which sounds so weird because we know what she does. She writes from the heart. She writes from her personal experience. She said it a million times. Okay, a million times, but I swear, man, she is just, what a songwriter. Okay, wow. So this is going to be song 7, and this is called Question, and on the track list here is Question dot dot question mark. I do like that. So let's see what's up with this one. You know, okay, so I want to say this before going on, is the other thing that's actually striking me really hard on this so far, these are all pretty short songs. There's not, so far I don't feel like we've got like that 6-7 minute type epic number. And so far these are all like in that 3 minute category, and any of these could rate. I mean, radio wise, I mean, I think Lavender Haze is definitely a radio song to me. It just feels like it. I think Antihero is just, wow. I'm still blown away with that. But yeah, this so far, this feels like a, well, it's weird. The timing feels like a pop record, but this isn't just like pop music. You know what I mean? It's like, it's such a weird thing. Like the production wise, it's almost like a mix of like a little bit of Rep Lover production wise, but the feel and some of the vocal stuff and the story of like folklore. You know what this is? I don't know what. Okay, so well, I'm officially getting to half the record. It feels like a masterpiece.